again, yeah, still in the 19th century, you had in the museums paintings were one on top of the other. There may have been 50 paintings on a wall like this, and now we have these white walls with just one or two paintings. So it enables you to have an existential relationship with the work of art. And related to this is what is a huge respect for arts, which is in the 20th century even higher than in the 19th century. In the concert hall, even up to the 1880s, people were still smoking, walking in and out. That's impossible in the 20th century. And that's the speculation. It could be that this very widely shared respect for art is now going down. It's not, it's still there, but the circles in which the respect is so large may become smaller. But we have to talk about that if we have enough time. So in this period, you could say art is good just in itself. And that is, these are stereotypes, of course. And they are infused with emotion. And the emotion is in the, well, you know, you have this art is beauty, art is deep. It creates profound human emotions. It enriches, it civilizes. Art is autonomous, art is authentic, unique. It's not commercial, etc. And that is that it is infused with emotion shows from expressions like, I ought to go more often. So the common man didn't take part in the art world, but he did have this respect. Or even your colleagues, if they're not, you know, if they're engineers or whatever, they may say, oh, I ought to go more often to the museum. Or in a way, even the other sentence, my daughter of six could do the same, is, yeah, it's aggressive in a way. So there must be something big in art. Otherwise, there would be no need to have expressions like that. Yeah? So it shows how much emotion we have invested in art. Okay. Same, of course, applies to artists. Artists are creative, authentic, they realize themselves, they're sensitive, all these stereotypes, you know them. And they are, of course, stereotypes in many ways. Artists are vulnerable, they're selfless, they do not care about money. And then, of course, many people around you who are non-artists may say, oh no, I'm not creative. So they're sort of, they don't even want to compete with you, say, I'm as good as you, as the artist. No, no, I'm not creative. You are the big man. Huh? So, this specialness, let me give an example. I'm sometimes in my science job, yeah, I'm sometimes invited to a circle of scientist or non-artist, yeah, and by a colleague of mine who's a professor in economics, and in his party there are all sorts of important people, various professionals, lawyers, etc. They come in, they are introduced by their name, nothing like that, nothing more like that, and then I come in and he says, oh, this is Hans Abbing, he's an artist. So suddenly it's important to add this term artist, which of course is very strange. Why should he do it? At that very moment, his own status rises by having a friendship with an artist, which is very, yeah. And of course I enjoy it as well, and the guests enjoy it. Suddenly there is an artist amidst them, somebody special. Why do we look up so much to art? So why do we put them in a special box? Again, I think it's this search for individuality which started in the 19th century and which is quite strong still, even though this search for who am I myself, in this the artist seems to be more successful. He finds expressions of himself, while everybody else, yeah, is still searching for oneself, and in the older days had to suppress himself. He had an assumption, there must be something there, but I can't show it, it's not allowed, I shouldn't show it, and then the artist can. So the artist is an individual, unlike other people. He's authentic. he's also honest to himself. He's allowed to be honest. Other people may have to cheat. And he's irreplaceable. Take a painter, Dutch painter, Karel Appel. You probably have heard of him. He was world famous. At the moment he dies, there are no more new Karel Appel paintings. It's finished. That is because his signature, his works are him, are an individual who expresses himself. Now take a CEO of a big company, of Sony. The day he dies, the next day there is an other director who is not exactly the same, who may change some policies, etc., but he's irreplaceable. Sony will go on. Yeah? So you can be a big shot in society, but you're not the artist. And that's what puts the artist separate. And that, of course, also explains why the signature of artists is so important and why we have an obsession with authentic works. We talked a bit about that yesterday, and we want to preserve these very individual expressions and are willing to pay a lot for it, even though we're not willing to pay a lot to many artists. Okay, we talked about this. So the search for one's true self is really, I think, the motor behind this respect for artists. And again, something may be changing nowadays, because I noticed among youngsters that they are not so much searching for being an individual or searching to be authentic. No, they are authentic, and they are supposed to be authentic. To belong to your group, you must be authentic. So that could imply that the artist becomes less important. Maybe everybody is a little bit of an artist now, and creative. Okay, becoming an artist. You can imagine that even though the prospects, the financial prospects, but also in many other ways of being an artist, there can be suffering involved, I'm quite sure. Still, people stimulate you to become an artist, all around. I know quite a bit about statistics, etc. And yet, when I have a life drawing class, I taught life drawing for quite a while, and to amateurs, but also some artists. And then you have this amateur who turns out to be much better than some of the artists in the class. And I cannot stop myself from suggesting to him, well, why not go to the art academy? Like, I assume that he will be a better person then, that he will be happier, although I know that he may also get into a miserable life. And even economists, who know better, may, the moment you are in a different circle, you are outside of a circle of economists, you get in the same sense of, oh, it would be so wonderful for somebody to become an artist. Let's not get into that. Of course, not everybody becomes an artist. You may have got so many contra signs of not being talented, or many art academies do have some form of examination for people to enter. So if the feedback is too negative, of course, you decide not to. Still, it's very tempting. Okay, let's go to another topic, artist attitudes, or the ethos, the art ethos of artists. I think it's very important for explaining several of the topics we've come across. I think any profession has attitudes or has an ethos. And it may have reference to many different topics. The attitude towards money, towards commerce, towards commissions, subsidies, work itself, towards second jobs, towards success, towards poverty, towards failure. I have some more. autonomy, quality, recognition by peers, all that may differ among professions, and in that sense it's very good to examine in which way artists work with these different values or attitudes. I won't go along all of them, but be assured that many of these attitudes are shared. Some are shared by almost all artists, so also the unsuccessful artist, the failing artist, the artist at the very top. Some of them are particular for subgroups, for circles between artists. And I'll try to find some examples. Anyway, how are these attitudes, for instance, towards money? Money should not be important or not be too important. Yeah, you don't do it for money. Many professions, you would say, you don't do it for money, but money is not completely unimportant. Yeah, even your position within the group may improve a little bit if you earn more money. And so you're also directed a bit by money. In the arts, you shouldn't be directed by money. You do it for art, yeah, art for art's sake, and in a way you do it for yourself, strangely enough. You're selfless and you're known to be selfless, and yet it's also for yourself being able to express yourself, to be this authentic person who is different from anybody else. So I would say there's a strange combination of being selfless, not after money, not after any other reward, and yet being selfless. That's interesting. I want to think a bit more about that, but that's I still have to do. So being sincere to yourself is also part of this artist attitude, being true to oneself. So people, that is a value which is shared very widely among artists, not only in the Netherlands, not only in Japan, also here, also in Taiwan, especially in, maybe we have to distinguish between contemporary artists and artists who do more traditional work, so that would be subgroups already, but among contemporary artists, these are important values. And so there are many others. Autonomy is important. And again, there are differences. Even here, you might say, well, a starting artist who's taking too many commissions, even within his work preference, or who would say, well, the commissions are important for me and I like them. He should say, no, I want to make my own work, but I have to take commissions because I have to survive as an artist. Then it's okay. But if he says, no, I like commissions, no, it's not okay. But if you're successful, then commissions get another status. So the value also among these young artists, they know once you're successful, commissions are okay. Again, a sort of a value, an ethos with all sorts of little differences. Let's see. Buyers, audiences. Purchases by governments are generally okay. Not always. By collectors are okay. But by private people, you have to already to be a bit careful. Maybe they're not the right people to relate with, or you could be seen as slightly commercial by your colleagues. So you have to be very careful how you handle the private market. Let's take another one. Public attention. Public attention is okay if it is a gift, if it comes to you. The same as money. Money is okay, but it should be a gift. You shouldn't have been after it. Yeah? In many other professions, pop musicians are allowed to be after attention. Politicians are allowed to be after attention. They can have actions which generate attention. Artists should not. And also, this carelessness with respect to money is very typical. Money may come in after a while. It may even be seen as deserved, but you shouldn't be after it. And you should be careless in a way. You don't show off money. Pop stars, sportsmen, they can show off, they are allowed to show off money. Artists are not. And it can even be an embarrassment, like the example of Freud and Bacon, who got rid of it as soon as possible by gambling. Okay. So, to return to professionality, professionality is very much determined by all these attitudes. Do you go along with the attitudes, then you're a professional? Do you not? You're not a professional artist. There's something wrong with you. And you will not be recognized by your peers. So it's not just the quality of work. It's an attitude, a collection of attitudes which make somebody to an artist. So also the failed artist, or the very poor artist, or the artist who is still very poor after and has hardly sold any work while he's 50 or 60, can still be an artist if he is still in this circle which is characterized by an attitude. And how is it? It's maintained, of course. Not all artists know one another, but you're in circles of artists, and it already starts at the art academy in the autonomous departments, not so much in the design departments. That's it. There you start to learn these rules, these attitudes, and you take them along with you. And quality of art is only one aspect of it. Many of these attitudes are far more persistent than the idea of quality. Quality in the 70s of the last century could still be figurative art, which was realistic, while in the 80s it became abstract and conceptual, and you got different teachers at the school. So that's much more, moves much more along, although it's, of course, it is circulated within circles of artists, some more and some less, but there's some more basic attitudes which persist for a long time. Well, commercial versus non-commercial. Here again, it's this, the art job must be the primary job, even though there's much more money coming in from the second job, from teaching at art academies or whatever. Even if you spend the large, only a few hours on art a week, if the attitudes are okay, and you're not saying, I'm a scientist, I'm in a careful, difficult position. Just a minute. So then you're an artist. You can be an artist. So my position, again, is a bit strange, because I play false. When I'm among artists, I will sort of say, well, I'm also doing a bit of science, but it's not so important. And I know better, and some know better, because I really appreciate both jobs. And I wouldn't say that my science job is my second job. There are two, so I keep them separate, the circles. I don't let them mingle too much. It's like a trick. But again, because I'm somewhat older, I'm not very successful, but I have a reputation as an artist. As I told you, I am recognized as an artist in the Netherlands, and especially as you're older, you can afford slightly more sidesteps. But if I would have started off as a scientist and would have gone into art and would not, and would have say, well, science is still very important of me, I could never have been an artist. Thank you.